Alright. Well, good afternoon, everybody. Hope you're doing well. Welcome to my return. I hope you guys learned a lot from Travis's lecture last week. I thought he did a great job, so. I just wanted to cover a few points, basically fill in some gaps from what he talked about last time, just in order to give kind of a more solid foundation to the use of turbulence, and how that kind of integrates into physical parameterizations. So one thing that he mentioned was the use of the Reynolds averaging. And so this is actually a common technique in order to derive basically how parameterizations are able to be incorporated into the equations of dynamics. So before we derive the whole set of Navier-Stokes equations, which represent large-scale flow, but it wasn't exactly clear in that case how these small sub-grid-scale characteristics would necessarily come in. And so I'm going to look briefly at the usage of water vapor and water vapor transport in order to understand how Reynolds averaging is used in order to kind of develop a in route for parameterizations to be introduced into the equations of motion. So far I've discussed three forms of the water vapor transport equation. One is the Lagrangian form, which basically says that the mixing ratio of water vapor within a particular element as you follow that fluid parcel around in space remains constant, regardless of how the fluid parcel deforms or wherever it moves. This has an equivalent Eulerian form. Do you remember how you get from the Lagrangian form to the Eulerian form? No, it's okay. I accept. And from the Eulerian form, if we combine that with the equation for density evolution, the so-called continuity equation of the equations of motion, we then obtain the conservative form of the water vapor transport equation. Do you guys remember what rho q is in this case? Rho q is the prognostic variable in the conservative form. What does it represent physically? Rho q, what's rho first of all?
What's the density?
What's rho times mixing ratio? First of all, what do I get? When it gets, what are the units of mixing ratio?
Kilogram per kilogram.
Yeah, kilogram per kilogram, or unitless. So if you take a density and multiply a density unit times something which is unitless, you get
density.
Density. So rho times q then is the density of moisture in the air. Exactly. So this is actually a mass conservation equation written for conservation of water mass. Form of water vapor. So the one I'm going to be concentrating on then is that conservative form of the equations and use that. So we can split the divergence term here on the right hand side into both horizontal and vertical components, in which case you end up with a form which looks like this. So you have a horizontal divergence operator, which I'm denoting by del sub h, and that's dotted with rho times the horizontal velocity times the water vapor concentration. And you have a vertical component, which is the z derivative of rho times the vertical velocity w times the local water vapor concentration, or mixing ratio. So we're going to introduce this concept of Reynolds averages. And the basic idea here is that we're splitting it into a resolved component, or a component which is averaged over a particular grid cell or time interval, and that's denoted by an overbar, and a perturbation from that. So in this case, that would represent large-scale motion in the form of the overbar, and perturbation, or eddy effects, or small-scale, sub-grid-scale behavior of that particular point. Now we're going to do a Reynolds average, or a Reynolds splitting into both a large-scale component and small-scale component of the horizontal, of the whole velocity field, and of the water vapor concentration. Now there are several rules that are associated with this split. And these are kind of derived from common sense as to how an averaging procedure should work. So the average of an average, that is, if you have a large scale effect and you ask, what is the large scale effect of that large scale effect? Well, it's just the large scale effect back again, right? So the average of an average is just equal to that original average. If you average over a perturbation, we're saying that that has zero contribution to the large scale. So if over a whole grid cell, you average over just the small subgrid scale effects, we're going to say that that has zero contribution to the total large scale effects, because those are all taken into account by the large scale effect denoted here. And then there's another concept, which is basically if you have a product of two things, so x and y, the average of x times y is just equal to the average of x times the average of y. Okay? So this is fairly logical, and with these three simple rules, it basically allows us to derive a bunch of consequences associated with these rules. So one example is, for instance, if we have x prime times y, and then the average of that whole thing, the average of that product, what is this going to be equal to?
Zero.
Why?
Well, you can split them up first.
Split them up.
X prime bar, y bar. And we know then x prime bar is zero.
And this one's zero. So zero times y bar is zero, right? So this is going to be a consequence of these rules that will then come into play later. How about x prime, y prime bar? What's that equal to?
Not zero.
Not zero. That's true. Because actually, I suppose there's a little error here, actually, because that can't be split up properly like that. Anyway, this generally only holds for the large scale, the averages of these quantities, I should probably know. So this one is not equal to zero. And that'll come in, and that'll be important later on, because you can imagine, for instance, if x and y are equal to one another, then you get x prime squared, and that's going to be a quantity which is inherently non-zero, and then if you average over a quantity which is inherently non-zero, it won't necessarily equal zero, or it won't equal zero. Sure. So using these rules then, we have the conservative form of the moisture transport equation up here, and we expand it out in terms of the horizontal u and the velocity field, and substitute those into the conservative form here, and then we're going to take the Reynolds average of the whole set of equations. So we're going to assume that the Reynolds averaging then can be placed inside of derivatives, so it's it commutes with the derivative operator. So in performing that, then we can take that, place it on the inside here, and we get rho times qv, all of that bar, in which case you get this rho q bar down here, and you get rho times q prime bar, but bar over q prime is equal to zero, and so that doesn't play a role in the time evolution of these equations here. For the horizontal divergence term, we're going to substitute it in, and you get four terms that actually pop out of this. So you have rho times uh plus uh prime times qv bar plus qv prime. This is going to be equal to rho times uh bar times qv bar plus rho times uh bar qv prime. Plus rho uh prime qv bar plus rho uh bar qv prime. And if we do the averaging over all these terms, then as we saw earlier, these two terms end up dropping out. Both of these go to zero. And so you just get a sum of these two terms. One is the individually split means. So this is the large scale influence. And this is the small scale eddy transport. And the reason that it's called eddy transport is because all of this transport is due to small subgrid scale effects, small perturbations or vortical effects in the velocity field, which contribute together in order to cause an upscale transfer on the, and influence on the large-scale effects as a consequence. So performing this on each of the terms, then both of the derivative terms on the interior get split up into two separate terms, one representing large scale effects and one representing small scale eddy transport effects. So individually, large scale horizontal transport, horizontal eddy transport, large scale vertical transport, and vertical eddy transport. So these two terms that are associated with turbulence in the model because they're small subgrid scale effects, and these two terms are associated with large scale effects which occur on the grid scale. Okay. So we can simplify this further with an observation, namely that horizontal and vertical fluxes are generally comparable, flux being the term inside the derivative in this case. But the vertical fluxes converge or diverge over much shorter distances than the horizontal fluxes. In the vertical, typically the convergence and divergence occurs over the distance of 2 to 3 grid cells, so about 300 meters. In the horizontal, it's over a 100 kilometer area. So this is part of the reason why we're able to have such a strong aspect ratio in the atmosphere, because these effects are basically preserve that aspect ratio in a physical sense as well. And so consequently, if these two terms on the inside are roughly the same as one another, but in the denominator, this thing has a very large denominator associated with this horizontal distance right here, and this one has a very small denominator, relatively speaking, associated with the vertical distance, then this term is going to be much larger than the horizontal eddy. And so generally what we do in for large-scale general circulation codes, ones where we have a horizontal scale which is much larger than the vertical scale, what is generally done is we end up dropping that additional horizontal eddy transport term in the equations. So one thing that you'll note is the fact that we've already introduced a parameterization concept which is not independent of the choice of horizontal grid scale. And going forward, this is an inherent problem, because as we have increased computational power, we're pushing our horizontal grid scale to be more on the order of the vertical grid scale. If we bring our model down to a horizontal resolution of approximately 3 kilometers, then suddenly we're only about 10 times bigger than the vertical grid scale, and those horizontal eddy transport effects will have an influence on the large scale flow. And so perhaps we can no longer make that assumption, and consequently our parameterization will need to be redesigned. But for large-scale effects, our goal then will be to parameterize this last term right here, which represents the vertical eddy transport term. And this is the one that Travis mentioned last time in his talk, when he showed that this it was through this eddy transport term that the turbulence parameterizations come into play. Okay. So he introduced also a bunch of different methods for parameterizing that particular term. Do you remember what the kind of first order approximation was? Well, do you remember what the zeroth order approximation was?
Get rid of it,
yeah. So that's the zero order approximation. We say that subgrid scale effects do not play a significant role. The consequence of that is, if you think back to the energy spectrum that I talked about a while ago, you'll end up with a very sharp cutoff associated with the energy spectrum. Because essentially what you're telling the numerical method is that nothing is going on beyond the grid cutoff. And if that's the case, then it's not going to have any energy coming back into the smallest scales, and so you're going to end up with an energy cascade which falls off rapidly as it approaches that grid scale, and not preserve the physical nature of the atmospheric grid scale. Do you guys remember the first order approximation of this term?
Diffusion,
exactly. So the concept is, we can say from a physical context that this maybe looks like diffusion. Do you know why? Why does that look like diffusion?
Well, W, is it possible to say that W is it's another partial Z?
Not really. W is just, this is like random perturbations in the W field. So it can be partially up, partially down. would argue that it's not really clear why this should be a fusion. But it's something that you can kind of see in practice. So here's an exciting video. So this is a Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. Imagine for a moment that we have a separation between two regions of fluid. At the top, we have a fluid with a small moisture content, so small QV, very small mixing ratio, roughly the same density between the two fluids. And at the bottom, we have a large QV, so a lot of moisture located in that area. And we have turbulence in the middle. Turbulence caused by small-scale eddy effects. So we'll assume for a moment that this represents one grid box, so this is 100 kilometers across, and this represents some vertical profile associated with moisture. So if we have this eddy effect going on in the middle, then presumably there would be some mixing occurring between the two fluids. So this is an example of a shear which triggers an instability to occur, and consequently we have turbulence appearing at the boundary between the two fluids. Now one thing I want you to take into account in this is the fact that we still have a large black region down at the bottom corresponding to this high moisture content. We still have a large white region at the top corresponding to this small moisture content. But in the middle, there's no longer this sharp divide between the two. Instead, we have kind of a mixture of both regions of small moisture content and large moisture content that have filtered down to such fine scales that everything kind of just looks gray now. Right? So if I was to plot a vertical profile associated with this moisture content, it would initially, so this is height, this is Q, so large Q initially, small Q there. As the simulation proceeds, actually what you get is something which looks like this, and then as the turbulence increases, it looks like that, eventually ends up looking like that, right? This is exactly what you would see if you looked at pure diffusion. This is just an initial heat profile, for instance, which is very hot here, very cold here, and you have regions which are very hot, near cold regions becoming cooler, regions which are very cool, near hot regions becoming hotter. And consequently, you get a smoothing of this profile. So analogously then, the presence of turbulence in this flow to a first order approximation very closely represents diffusion. Questions? This is actually on Wikipedia for Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. Okay, so to a first order approximation, then we can say that this eddy mixing term in vertical corresponds then very closely to a diffusive term. And so this is our first approximation then to how turbulence is going to be affecting the flow. So I want to talk briefly on atmospheric features by resolution and how they play into the type of parameterizations that we require for our students. So the current standard operational climate model resolution is approximately 110 kilometers. This is as of 2012. Going forward, we're going to be reducing our resolution, so moving into regions closer and closer to the bottom left. What I'd like to demonstrate in this plot is the fact that anything to the top right of the red box I show here is what is considered to be resolved. So these are large enough that you can see them on the grid scale and consequently capture them in a large scale model. Anything within the box is things that we need to parameterize. So even at our current resolutions, there's a pretty significant number of atmospheric features which kind of fit into this domain, including, I would say that cumulonimbus convection is just barely resolved. I would say not even particularly well resolved in our current climate. Cumulus convection is definitely not resolved. This is associated with individual clouds within our grid scale, especially in the tropics where you have regions of very strong vertical updraft. Microscale turbulence, like I showed you in the previous slide, these are things which occur in the boundary layer associated with turbulent motion. And the fact that you never have flows which are all perfectly flowing in the same direction. So in our push to really get down to very fine scales, the next generation models are kind of heading towards this 25 kilometer resolution. So the nice thing about hitting 25 kilometer resolution is that one can argue that at 25 kilometers we can actually resolve tropical cyclones at all. And the reason for that is because we kind of captured this cumulonimbus convection regime. We're able to resolve the eyewall associated with tropical cyclones at 25 kilometer resolution, or sorry, not the eyewall, but the eye of the tropical cyclone we can resolve at 25 kilometers. It's only one or two grid cells, but you can see it in a simulation showing a tropical cyclone. So this is the experimental global climate resolution, but dropping it from 110 kilometers down to 25 kilometers, that's four times the horizontal resolution, and consequently, in terms of computational cost, what is that? Relative to the 110 kilometer simulation.
32 or 16?
Not quite.
More?
Yeah. Name all your powers of two. 64. So it's eight times to go from 100 kilometers down to 50 kilometers, and then eight times more in order to go from 50 kilometers down to 25 kilometers. So this is pretty much the edge of our current computational regime. We can barely do climate simulations in this regime, mainly from a funding standpoint. Because if you go to the DOE and say, I want to use your entire supercomputer for several months, they can be somewhat wary about giving you access to that many resources all at once, especially with just one project. So only a few climate simulations have actually been run at those resolutions. But it's really what we're pushing for in order to get the resolutions we need in order to do things like tropical cyclone statistics, interannual variability, and other things are associated with extreme weather events. Going forward, we end up with 10 kilometers. 10 kilometers is what I would call the end of climate modeling as you see it today. The reason being, at 10 kilometers, we no longer have the hydrostatic assumption that we can rely upon, so we need to go to more expensive non-hydrostatic models which have additional prognostic variables that need to be tracked around. Certain parameterizations need to be turned off or modified when you get to this scale. And in fact, there's this whole regime, which is often referred to as parameterization no man's land, going from 10 kilometers down to 3 kilometers, where we don't really know what to do from a parameterization standpoint. I'm saying this as the general climate modeling community. We don't know what to do in this regime because we don't really want to parameterize it because some of those effects are actually on the grid scale, but we don't want to make it on the grid scale because a lot of those effects are still too small to be captured on the whole large grid scale. So you have to have like a half-assed parameterization that sometimes turns on and other times doesn't turn on. And it's generally just very difficult for you to figure out when to do that properly. So instead of doing that, why not just go down to 3 kilometers? 3 kilometers is what we would refer to as cloud resolving scale. At this point, we have encompassed the whole cumulus convection portion of this plot and have partially gone into, or sorry, the whole cumulonimbus convection portion of this plot and gone into cumulus convection. So at 3 kilometers then, we can say that we are starting to resolve large-scale cloud systems. We're able to get vertical convection mostly right without the need for an explicit parameterization for convection. And so consequently, this is going to be the real push, probably in the next 20 years or so, in order to try to get to this 3 kilometer scale and completely skip over everything between 10 kilometers and 3 kilometers. It's not worth it in order to try to figure out what to do in between, because the parameterizations get very complicated in that regime. So as it stands, business as usual, climate modeling up to about 10 kilometers. Even then, it's kind of sketchy. I really wouldn't go any finer than like 15 kilometers for business as usual. And this is a problem which actually ECMWF has even seen. ECMWF, they run numerical weather prediction models at very fine horizontal resolutions, even down to 10 kilometer scale. And at 10 kilometers, even for numerical weather forecasting, their convective parameterizations are hyperactive. Namely, you have convective parameterization, you have large scale convection associated with just solving the equations of motion. If you add those two together, sometimes they'll exceed 100%. 100% is kind of the natural amount of convection that you want in your scheme. your parameterization does 80% and your dynamics does 60%, then suddenly you're getting way too much convection in your systems. And so what ECMWF actually found, even at 10 kilometers resolution, they got better results when they turned off their convective parameterization. So that's starting into this whole parameterization no man's land thing. Okay, so I want to discuss why how parameterizations are kind of specified in the community atmosphere model. So they have four different design philosophies that need to be followed for every parameterization that you put into CAM. Number one, inputs and effects must be totally contained into single columns. So that's the idea of column physics. You can only use information that's directly above you or directly below you at any given point in order to compute the parameterization update. Schemes do not possess a memory. That is, I can't remember what happened to me during the previous model time step. I can only work on what the instantaneous state of the large scale system. There must be a sufficient space-time volume in the grid in order to maintain good statistics. That is, a lot of the parameterizations are based on assumptions that within the grid you have at least 20 instances of a particular effect, such as a cloud. If you have only one cloud within your at your grid scale, then you no longer have good statistics. You can't necessarily trust those parameterizations in order to give you the results that you want. And for climate, you need to conserve mass, momentum, and energy. So limiters and fixers may be needed in order to do this, but this actually turns out to be one of the easier problems to deal with. Going forward, 1, 2, and 3 are problematic for various reasons. Number 1, if we get down to a horizontal grid scale, which is comparable to the vertical grid scale, then suddenly, over the course of a model time step, your physics is going to be very rapidly communicating with. This communication can occur much faster than the physics interactions, which are coupled every half an hour in the code. Schemes cannot possess a memory. Again, if your time steps are very small, associated with your CFL condition requiring for your time steps to be small, then assuming that you have no memory of what happened 5 seconds ago is a bit excessive. I mean, most of these parameterizations have goldfish-like memories, but not quite that bad. And assume sufficient space-time volume in grid means for good statistics. If our grid scale is down on the size of one cloud, then we no longer have this concept of average statistics associated with the grid scale. Now we have either one cloud or no cloud. Other issues, dynamics parameterization coupling. So dynamics and physics parameterizations are basically individual functions or operators that you apply to the current state of the system in order to update it. There's many ways in which you can apply these operators in such a way that you get a final updated state. So the two most common ways are known as process split and time split parameterizations. So for process splitting, all parameterizations work on the same state and provide tendencies for the update. So in this case, we have an initial state, say at time September 3rd at 12 p.m. And we want to update it to the next state, which is September 3rd at 12:05 p.m. The dynamics is going to say, okay, this is what the state was like at noon. I'm going to calculate the time tendency of density, momentum, and energy. The surface fluxes are going to say, okay, I'm going to calculate the time tendency of moisture, which is coming up from the ocean. Clouds are going to say, okay, we know stuff about the vertical velocity at this point, so we're going to use that in order to compute information on macro scale cloud behavior and other physics parameterizations. They all use this initial information in order to provide the tendency for the update, and then we just continue doing that. The alternative is the time split parameterization, in which case we have an initial state, we apply dynamics to that initial state, we get an updated state. We apply surface fluxes, we get an updated state. We apply another physics parameterization, we get an updated state. Continue. And finally, you get an updated state, and then that loops back to the beginning. Okay. So, what do you guys like? Which one sounds better? turns out numerically, time splitting is not particularly accurate. And the reason being, if I say I'm going to do an update at noon using my current state of the system, and Dynamics goes first, and Dynamics is like, okay, this is what things look like at 12:05. And then Service Fluxes takes the 12:05 information and says, okay, that's our input. That's what things look like at noon. They like to change their watch. And then they take that and they say, okay, this is what things look like at 12:05. And then repeat for various parameterizations. For them, as many stages as you have, they basically just keep setting the clock, their own local time back farther and farther and farther associated with those. And so this can cause problems. However, process splitting also has issues associated with it. In process splitting, the issue is more one of physical conservation. Namely, we almost never see supersaturation in the atmosphere. Namely, we never see a relative humidity which is greater than 100% in the atmosphere. So, if we have an initial state which is very close to being supersaturated, we have an initial state here, which is very close to being supersaturated, so this is Q. And then, okay, this is Q, this is fine. And then Dynamics says, okay, there's gonna be a convergence, water vapor is gonna increase at that particular location. And so at the next time step, we're going to have Q plus 1. Okay. But it turns out that Q plus 1 is supersaturated. Okay. So when one of the physics parameterizations comes around for large-scale condensation, for instance, which takes that water vapor and says, am I supersaturated? If I am, then rain it out. It's going to look at this initial state and say, nope, not supersaturated, we're fine. And so at the end of the time step, you're going to end up with a state which is supersaturated because the large-scale condensation never saw the fact that the dynamics forced it to be supersaturated. Okay. You also may think that, from a numeric standpoint, that this is kind of a trivial decision. There was a paper by Dave Williamson in 2006 that actually went into CAM and changed the parameterization coupling between the two of these. And he found statistically significant differences in the climatology that came out of CAM over something like 60% of the Earth's surface associated with simply making this simple change in the numerics.
Does time splitting, does the accuracy depend on the order in which the
yes.
called?
Yes. The accuracy does depend on the order. The results will depend on the order. Both are, generally, individually, they leave something to be desired. And coming up with a good way to couple disparate processes like this is another outstanding problem in design error climate models work. Doing a good job of design error climate models. So this is kind of something which often gets pushed under the rug, because the scientists would say, okay, well, this is not science-y related at all. This is a numerical bug. Numericists would be like, well, the only reason that this arises is because you have physical parameterizations which rely on detecting supersaturated states at any particular time, so it's a science problem. And so nobody really pays too much attention to this, except, yeah. So fortunately we have people like Dave Williamson. And Dave Williamson's job, if you've ever read any of Dave Williamson's papers, Dave Williamson's job is to find all the stuff that people swept under the rug and show that it's probably something that shouldn't. It turns out that one of these things is the physics dynamics coupling. Okay. So the way that the CAM time step generally works then is a time splitting based approach. And it proceeds in a circle as follows. We initially have a dynamic step, and then surface fluxes are computed based on the results from the dynamic step. Boundary layer results are computed from that. Shallow convection, then deep convection, then cloud macrophysics, having to do with basically the amount of cloud cover that you have in a particular grid zone. Cloud microphysics, which computes precipitation amounts and any transfers between individual states for water. This interacts with the aerosol parameterization, depending on the version of CAM you have. And so this needs to incorporate information on local aerosols in order to determine how much condensation is occurring. And aerosols also receive information from surface models, which correspond to surface emissions of aerosols. And radiation is then computed using after microphysics is done. And radiation uses the results from microphysics in order to do computations on the number of water particles, which are in a given cell, number of water droplets, in order to compute scattering associated with radiation effects. And then this basically just continues moving around. So there's a number of communications which need to occur between stages of this cycle for each of these individual processes. And a lot of effort, which is now being put into next generation climate model design, is actually in unifying these processes. So for clouds in particular, that is one area that we know of which reacts badly to having time split parameterizations. And consequently, for clouds, we can actually combine these four, shallow convection, deep convection, macrophysics, and microphysics, in one block and call it clouds. And that would dramatically cut down on the number of disparate processes which occur over a given CAM time step. And consequently, the assumption is, the hypothesis is, at that case, that would reduce errors in the model associated with this numerical splitting. And so there's two projects underway at NASA Center for Atmospheric Research to do that right now. One is the Unicon parameterization developed by Sung Soo Park, and the other is the CAM Club, the CLUBB parameterization suite. I don't remember who's pushing that one. So there's a lot of work to be done in this area, that's for sure. So I wanted to touch briefly on large-scale condensation and kind of walk you through the development of a very simple physics parameterization. So large-scale condensation is perhaps one of the simplest. How large-scale condensation basically works is that it says, am I supersaturated? If I'm supersaturated, condense all that water out. We don't observe supersaturated regions in the atmosphere, and consequently the assumption is that condensation works on such a fast time scale that it's effectively the same as as never really surpassing saturation. So for large-scale condensation, then, we say that there's going to be a condensation rate which takes water vapor out of the atmosphere and replaces it with liquid water. And that condensation rate is simply going to be given by capital C, and it's a source term on the right-hand side of the water vapor evolution equation. So for a particular grid cell, the mixing ratio associated with water vapor is going to be removed or reduced at a rate corresponding to the condensation rate. Heating due to condensation will then occur due to latent heating, the fact that you're converting from water vapor to water liquid, and that's going to occur at a rate given by L over Cp, where L is the latent heat of vaporization associated with water, and Cp is going to be the specific heat of dry air. So it's basically a transfer of heat then from the water condensation into the local temperature from dry air. And the saturation of specific humidity is determined via the Clausius-Clapeyron relation. Have you guys all learned Clausius-Clapeyron? So this is basic cloud macrophysics, and basically says that there's a specific saturation mixing ratio associated with water vapor. If your water vapor mixing ratio gets above the saturation mixing ratio, then it's considered to be supersaturated. So this represents the maximum amount of water vapor that a particular air parcel can contain. And it's a function of both temperature and pressure, and is approximately given by this relationship right here, where epsilon and E naught star are both constants. And L is latent heat of vaporization of water, and RV is the ideal gas constant associated with water vapor. So we never observe QV is larger than QSAT, so it is reasonable to assume that condensation occurs as a nearly instantaneous process, and it's a mechanism in order to reduce reduce water vapor to saturation. So reduce QV in a grid cell down to QSAT. So we're going to make some approximations on how the adjustment is performed. We're going to say, so these aren't approximations, sorry. This is, the adjustment is going to be performed essentially as a water vapor update, QV at time step n plus 1. So after condensation has occurred, we're going to have a water vapor update mixing ratio, which is equal to the original water vapor mixing ratio plus a change in the water vapor mixing ratio. And similarly, we're going to assume that the temperature is an instantaneous change. It goes from a temperature at the initial time, Tn, to an updated temperature at the later time, and that there's going to be a change in temperature, delta T. And from the last slide, we have that any change in the moisture content of that cell will be applied directly to heating within that cell. And so the temperature change is going to be equal to negative L over Cp times the change in water vapor. So if water vapor increases in the cell, not going to occur due to condensation, but if it increases, then temperature goes down. If water vapor decreases, then temperature goes up. And the change in water vapor concentration within the cell is going to be simply a reduction of the saturated mixing ratio at the updated time step minus the initial saturated, or the initial mixing ratio of water vapor. And the reason that this is evaluated at the later time step is because after this application, you want to make sure that your cell is still not super saturated. Notable, we assume that everything occurs at constant pressure. So in this formulation, the pressure within the cell does not change. This P is the P initial, P at time n is equal to the P at time n plus 1 half of this operator so far. Okay, so math occurs. We're going to approximate the saturation value of Q by the saturation mixing ratio at the initial time, so at time Tn, plus a derivative term. So this is just a first order Taylor series expansion of the QSAT about the point Tn, and it basically just looks like this. If we take that QSAT then, plug it in here, and plug the resulting update into here and solve for delta T, then you basically end up with a temperature update equation that looks like this, where dQ sat dT can be arbitrary. In this case, it's going to be the derivative of the Clausius-Clapeyron relation. But if you have something more complicated, then you can plug that in there. And consequently, when you solve for the change in temperature, that immediately gives you a change in the mixing ratio of water vapor. And then consequently, the condensation rate is simply equal to the duration of the time step. So 1 over the duration of the time step. So if your time step is very, very short, then the condensation rate is much faster. And that's going to be multiplied by this delta Q. Okay. So that's fairly complicated, but that's a simple derivation of a parameterization, which is common to pretty much any atmospheric model that you can see out there. The consequence of this is somewhat arbitrary, and it depends on the choices that you make in the atmospheric model. Some models insist that it rains out immediately, so you don't even have to keep track of water, liquid water which is floating around in the atmosphere as a prognostic variable. Instead, the water is just assumed to precipitate out in the form of precipitation, and the condensation rate will then give you the large-scale precipitation rate within that cell. Or it can be treated as a Q water, which is a mixing ratio of the amount of water within the cell, and then that can be transported around as a prognostic variable. How often this is applied is also a modeling choice. In CAM, this is applied every half an hour. In the German DWD model, this is applied after everything, pretty much. They basically say, never allow super saturation to occur ever. So after they do radiation update, large-scale condensation. After they do dynamics, large-scale condensation. After a subsite, so if they have Runge-Kutta time-stepping built into their method, if you recall in Runge-Kutta time-stepping, it has a bunch of substeps in it. After every subset, That way they guarantee that they never have a cell which is supersaturated. You can imagine that this is a design decision which can have an effect on the overall climatology. And it may be responsible for certain biases if you don't take care of this right away. And so, yeah, it's tough. It's a design decision, and one that you need to test in your model in order to see what order, in order to decide which order produces the best possible climatology. Now, if you're a math student sitting at the back of the room right now, you're probably thinking, oh my god, I can't believe this is what our climate models are based on. I don't think this is convergent at all. And yes, it's not convergent at all. Please don't go running to like climate skeptic blog or something like that. Paul told me these horrible things that the climate scientists do. Yeah, they'll just, yeah. The point is, often it's a game of just trying to figure out the right order to do things in. And often it's just trial and error in order to figure out how to do these parameterizations correctly. Because the climate system is so complicated, it contains so many different components to it, that getting them to all play together nicely is a difficult problem. It's almost as if each of these is a very belligerent child, and you want to get them together in a small room and get them to agree to do math problems together. It's difficult. But one that we're making continuous progress on. So I've only got a couple minutes left. Let me just discuss quickly clouds. So in the tropics, generally, we have these large-scale cloud systems which need to be parameterized from where they go. So we have a motion of the cloud systems from east to west. The development of the cloud from small-scale cloud phenomenon with an inversion layer, which generally looks to the surface. And as it develops, we get large-scale updrafts, which then force the development of these very tall anvil-like cumulus clouds with very heavy precipitation associated with them. And then that has the effect of basically stabilizing the atmosphere and leading to the removal of this inversion layer and pushing it back down to the surface. So with regards to clouds, treatment of clouds is probably one of the biggest sources of uncertainty, and consequently it's one where there's probably the most money if you're interested in going into climate modeling. Convective clouds consist of both deep and shallow convection. A lot of deep convection in the tropics that needs to be handled. All of this stuff occurs just below the grid scale. So it's something which needs to be captured by the parameterization, but something that needs to behave well with when interacting with dynamics. Stratiform clouds need to be considered properly. They are associated with convective detrainment, frontal lifting, orographic lifting. So you have to take into account the topographic effects, which may be driving cloud phenomena. An issue with topographic effects is that topography, although a large amount of it occurs at the grid scale, topography is known as a fractal phenomenon. Namely, no matter how small scale you go on the grid, you're still going to end up creating more and more small scale artifacts associated with the topography. It never converges to a particular smooth profile. And consequently, regardless of what your horizontal grid scale is, you're going to have drivers in the topography which are going to be basically affecting the behavior of the atmosphere above that point. The way that they do it in climate models right now is they typically have a surface roughness, which is basically a single quantity associated with the grid cell, which says how rough is that underlying cell. And then they use that in order to simply apply a friction on flow that is moving across that boundary. Now that's difficult because it doesn't necessarily lead to the generation of vertical updrafts, which may be associated with sharp changes in topography. Maybe next time I'll show a picture of like Flatirons from Colorado. The fact that you have this sudden rapid change of topography that goes like airflow coming in, up, and over. And you get a lot of weird effects associated with that. And another one is marine saturated cumulus clouds. These are very poorly understood from both a scientific point of view as well as how to incorporate them into models. And they have a fairly significant effect on how radiation is handled within the model. And you can see that right here. These two regions represent two portions of marine stratocumulus clouds. But here there's a very high albedo. So the albedo here is probably 0.8 or 0.9. and consequently you get a lot of reflection of sunlight in this region, whereas here, the clouds are much smaller, and you have a much smaller albedo, probably closer to 0.3 or 0.4, and so there's going to be more absorption of shortwave radiation in these areas. And so understanding where this transition between these cells occur is a major factor in making sure that we compute radiation properly over those regions. Okay, so that's enough for today. Any questions? Anybody deciding to no longer pursue climate modeling because it's scary? Just a reminder, course projects and reading assignments.